Hello and welcome to the Will Leitch Show. I am the aforementioned Will Leitch, and I thank you for spending part of your day with me. Okay, first things first, I have a book you absolutely have to buy. It is called Big Game, written by today's guest, Mark Leibovich, and it is one of the best sports books I have ever read. Now, I've been a huge fan of Leibovich's political writing for years. He's most famous for This Town, but my favorite is Citizens of the Green Room, which is a collection of his brilliant political profiles. But this book is unlike any other sports book because it reveals the dirty secret behind all of sports. The people in charge are morons. Now, this is true in all of society, of course. After all, look around at everything. But there is an illusion that the institutions of sports are being tended to by wise, benevolent caretakers who make sure all our sports remain the tradition we pass down to future generations. They are not run by those people. They are run by imbeciles. Sports survive in spite of them, not because of them. And none are worse than the NFL owners, a gaggle of legacy billionaires, none of which have ever had a real job, who've gotten rich solely because they happened to be standing nearby as America grew more obsessed with their increasingly violent sport, but who also think that they, of all people, are actually the reasons we watch. These dopes don't just not realize how freaking lucky they are, they actually think they're important. There is Daniel Snyder, who, as Leibovich notes in his book, there are venereal diseases that are easier to get rid of. There is Mark Davis, who looks like he has a family tree that is a straight line. There, and of course, there is Jerry Jones, whose very face looks like the rise, fall, and decay of the American dream. In their eyes, they are all great men, Americans, barbarians at the gate. But Leibovich sees them for what they are, sad little men who mostly couldn't write their name in the ground with a stick, propped up only by the positions they were mostly born into. And if to prove it, they keep telling Leibovich things they shouldn't, little tells of their own inadequacies and fears and dipshitteries. There isn't an NFL owner who doesn't show his ass a little bit in this book. Leibovich is a reporter, but to them, he's a chronicle of their status as important men. I'd say they know better now that the book is out, but I'm not sure they can actually read. There is always talk that the NFL is in trouble or is ending or faces some sort of existential peril. I don't know if this is true or not, but I will say NFL owners have an undeniable senators in the last days of Rome vibe to them. Whether you love the NFL or not, after reading Big Game, it is unquestionable that it is run by the most vile, worst, dumbest people imaginable. We all get the great men that we deserve. Okay, joining me today is Chief National Correspondent for the New York Times Magazine and author of the books This Town, Citizens of the Green Room, and the just released Big Game, the NFL in Dangerous Times. Please welcome the annoyingly talented Mark Leibovich. Sir?
This isn't fake. This is real crowd noise.
This is real. Yeah, this is real.
Really crowd it's,
I know. It gets a little embarrassing when they come after
you like
this.
I
know.
I kind of totally. No, I really like it.
It's kind of hard.
It's kind of hard.
Thank you. Sorry, I forgot to show the book and the thing when I did the intro.
Very humbling.
Yeah, of course.
That welcome. I really, really appreciate it.
I'm sorry. It does get a little embarrassing. Thank you for coming on. I have been proposed. You missed the intro. I did an essay where I just told you how great the book was. So just so you know.
You want to just repeat it?
Yeah, it sounds good to me, actually. Here's my question. One of the many great things about your book is it kind of shows a dirty secret about sports in general, but the NFL in specific,
right,
which is that it's run by idiots.
Yes.
And that is like a hard thing for me. Like, not that I thought the NFL was some well-oiled machine or something,
right,
but it is a little surprising to realize, oh, they're actually morons. Was it surprising to you?
You know, it shouldn't have been, but it was. Yeah. Here's the thing about the NFL. You watch it, and they're really, I guess, a really good production company. Because it is a big deal to put on big, massive, spectacle football games in which things have to go right. And obviously not everything goes right because there are official screw-ups, right, and everything. But no, I mean, it looks like it's something that just runs really well. But yes, you then meet the people, and it is a total letdown. Although not really, because I'd kind of heard this and sort of sensed this from being a fan and sort of watching it from the outside.
Well, because this is the thing about, right, you know, when you write about sports professionally, you know, I figure when you write about politics, you just kind of, you know everybody's craven and so on. But with sports, a lot of people don't like covering sports that really love sports. This
right.
is the problem for me when I came in.
Yes.
I have to make sure I want to still like sports, and I don't know if I want to meet the people like sports. You struggle with that a little bit in the book.
Yes.
Do you still like the NFL now?
Yes, but I reserve the right not to at any second when the Patriots start losing.
I understand.
See, that's another thing that I have to apologize for, because I'm a Patriots fan. I'm
a Cardinals fan. We get the same thing.
You know,
St. Louis Cardinals.
We both have a way attached to us.
I know. Well, listen, if other people can't get it figured out, they should follow the direction.
They should follow our way and then like get busted for, you know, whatever our teams get busted.
trying to win. That's what they try to get busted for.
Yeah, baby. They're just jealous. They hate us because they ain't us. But no, so I was, you're right. I did not want to cover sports because I just liked it too much. Here's the thing. I will watch a game tomorrow night, but I reserve the right just to stop cold turkey or gradually or something. I mean, I'm actually, and I don't know if this is a political statement or a statement of principle, but I'm not paying the NFL for anything this year. I've decided that I will not, you know, buy Sunday ticket. I'm not going to buy Red Zone. I just want to maybe scale back a little bit so that I'm not writing a check.
I find it kind of funny because baseball is my first sport. Mm-hmm. And the idea of not liking baseball is like not liking air. Like it's just a basic, like there's not a situation unless they just change the rules where everybody runs backwards and on their hands. As long as it's still the same
it
game.
It might come to that.
It could. But Manfred's got all sorts of crazy ideas.
Exactly.
But I can't imagine ever not liking baseball. But football, I kind of, like every year I take like a little bit more of a step back and a little bit more of a step back. And if you told me 15 years ago that, someday you just won't watch football. And listen, I am watching football now.
Right.
But the idea of not watching football is a thought.
It is a thought.
And it's weird. Like, again, I've not gone all the way with it. I'm still watching. I'm a professional sports reporter. It would feel professionally irresponsible not to watch football.
Yes. But certainly, and I admire your responsibility.
Of course, I am here. Listen, I have a sacred responsibility to the people.
As you do.
But for me, the idea of not watching it, I can imagine it. And I want to, and that kind of comes across in the book a lot of ways. Particularly the my favorite, everybody has a favorite chapter for this. I love the stuff with the owners. To me, I'm just obsessed with these owners. Mark Davis is...
he's beautiful.
It really does. I've written about this with your book before. It does kind of have a Fall of Rome vibe to it.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, you know, I do have, I don't know if I do this by design or not, but I do have like a last days of an empire fetish. Like Washington has always the Fall of Rome fetish, which is sort of a constant condition. And maybe the NFL too. I mean, maybe I don't have the same historical perspective that I do. But no, there does because... There have been instances in the last few years where you just have no idea how the league is going to get out of something. Like the Ray Rice thing, I mean, they were just floored, literally.
Well, sorry, bad example.
Bad example.
Sorry.
Roger Goodell was just, I mean, absolutely, I mean, they remember there were a couple days where like, does he survive? What do they do?
Course,
they just don't know.
You know, he's going to make it through the week.
It just felt like a spiral. Same thing in a weird way after, you know, Trump started piping up about the national anthem last year. It was like, they didn't have a plan. It's like, their ratings seemed to be like going down. And what's amazing is just the complete lack of leadership, both at Park Avenue and at the teams. And yet, I tried to have fun with this.
I think, and that's kind of the last thing too. Is when it comes to Goodell, he seems to represent that lack of leadership and that kind of treating the job as like a bad public relations person who's constantly following the news rather than like getting ahead of it. It always feels like that feels like his sin, like his major thing that he screws up all the time.
Yeah,
is following the news rather than getting ahead
of it. Yes, but you know what else? It's invisibility. It's like he's given up. Yeah. It's like you can go one of two ways when you sign a long-term new contract, which he did last year. That's going to, you know, give him maybe $200 million over the next 4 or 5 years. Yeah, clearly. You can go one way, which is to completely just like go balls to the wall. Can you say balls?
You can say balls to the wall.
Okay.
You can't say wall, but you can say balls. Some sort of flat surface.
Thank you.
That stands up.
But no, you can take chances. You can be bold. You can say, Mr. President, don't attack our league. Do something. Right. Or you can go the other way, which is just like completely check out. And
it does feel like he's checked out. You don't see him that much.
He doesn't even try. Yeah. And like, I don't know. I mean, it's an odd thing because I think the owners, I don't know if they noticed or not because they're all getting rich. Yeah. But I mean, they're all rich anyway. But it's an odd thing.
Well, you already see it too. You see it with, like, the ratings have gone up a little bit this year.
Yeah.
And as someone that has written a few of those, is football in trouble? Inevitably, someone will be like, oh, I thought you said the NFL was dying. Look at all the people that watch Thursday Night Football.
You know, it is great for, like, the sort of chin-stroking, thumb-sucker columnist industry,
right? Oh, it's so wonderful.
So what else is there?
I don't even feel like I need to watch football that much. I can just have thoughts about it as a concept.
Isn't that great?
Oh, it's so nice.
That's the future of print journalism. or even broadcast journalism.
Then we're going to be fine.
We're going to be fine. We just need takes.
This
is what the kids call it.
That's what they call it, takes. I think you're supposed to spell it T-A-E-K-S.
Does that actually have its own spelling?
You're supposed to be reacting so much that you don't have time to actually spell
That's sort of
a
like
very
an
basic
inside,
verb.
Wow, sort of like lead in newspaper,
exactly.
Although there's not like a time save there.
Yeah, people are just mad. They're just mad and stomping things.
I mean, there have been times when I've actually, like, even on Twitter, like, written lead, L-E-D-E, which is like the newspaper way to...
Of course.
I don't have to explain this to you, but many people like say, hey, you know, there's a misspelling. Like, first of all, who corrects spelling in a tweet?
Yeah.
Anyway.
So, okay, we have a section we call Frivolous Questions of Dubious Import, in which case I ask
I've
you...
I've built a career
you
on
specific
that.
These questions. Exactly. Okay, so my first question, so these are just specifically for you. Some of them are political related, some of them are sports related. Whose job would you personally want less, Mike Allen's or Adam Schefter's?
Wow.
I'm a serious reporter, and I ask very difficult questions.
I would say, no, job or life?
I mean, is there a difference when it comes to either one of those
true.
Two?
No, that's true. Yeah, that's actually true. I guess I would like to have Mike's job a little less, because I'm guessing Adam gets paid more, but I could be wrong.
Yeah. I would.
I mean, it's
so.
A kind of a clinical answer, but I'll just
fair enough.
Go with that.
They both seem like just. I can't think of a thing. It doesn't even feel like it's the same field as what I do.
Exactly, and it's true. And yet, you know, I mean, I read them. I respect.
Yeah. I get
everything.
It. Yeah,
no,
it's
I mean,
not to say
it doesn't.
That,
no, it's a whole different speed. Yeah. And there's like, look, the whole industry is at that speed in many ways.
I know. It's
crazy.
That's the scary part. Yes. Of all the owners that you interviewed, who did you actually find to be the dumbest?
The dumbest.
We had a bet with the producers whether you'd answer this question. I said yes, because he is a truth teller.
Yeah, I'm a truth teller.
Exactly. He's a teller of
dumbest,
truth.
Dumbest, I mean, oh, man. See,
I know, it's
no,
so
no,
hard to
I don't. I don't. It's hard to single it out. It's like choosing one of your kids.
It's it's choosing which one of your kids
I guess I'll just go with Woody Johnson.
Woody Johnson?
Yeah. I mean, it's not like... It was like overwhelming. You know, this is your ambassador, or my ambassador.
Of course, of course. I feel very safe.
It just seems like it just. I don't know. I want to say Woody Johnson.
Okay, Woody Johnson.
Sorry, Woody.
I would have guessed Davis. I feel like Davis, but
you know what?
I feel like he just looks dumber. Is not actually. I mean, he's still dumb.
Yeah, I mean, I talked to him. There's something about Mark Davis that I certainly wouldn't say is brilliant, but there is a. There's something about him that is very easily underestimated in the same way that you can easily underestimate like this. Cup of soda, right? And yet, he pulls off things like, you know, the Vegas deal,
which
was arguably terrible for football, and I mean, just hypocritical for all on any number of reasons, but it worked. And like, how did he do that? So I think Seth Wickersham and Don Van Atta, in one of their pieces about the league, I think quoted someone, I forget who it was, saying, Mark Davis, I mean, this is a guy like, you just sort of, you marvel if he can actually get out of bed and put his pants on.
Right.
I mean, to me.
It's like, I always joke that he looks like John Gruden. Like, remember in RoboCop, in RoboCop, when the toxic waste falls on the guy right before the car runs into him?
Yeah,
he kind of looks like John Gruden after that.
And I think that's why there was a level of comfort that led him to hire John Gruden.
Yeah. Exactly.
Over 10
He's
years,
like, oh,
however
okay.
many years.
This is what I looked like before the spill.
Yeah.
Okay, my favorite character in your book is Tom Brady's dad. Tom Brady's dad is awesome.
He's
the best. I have a theory. Everyone, you know, you kind of chase Tom Brady around in the book, and he's kind of a thing. But my theory is a lot of people like Tom Brady's gone into Tom Cruise, Michael Jackson, Weirdland.
Sure.
My theory is that once he retires, he will actually be kind of interesting and like his dad. Is that? Do you think that will happen?
Maybe. I mean, I do think. Well, first of all, if Tom Sr. is watching, and I hope he is.
I mean, yeah.
We love you, Tom.
We have him right here.
Tom,
he's right here at the desk.
Tom, you're the best. No, he. He's great. I don't know. Maybe. I mean, I think that there is an honesty. They are very much, I mean, for as diplomatic as Tom Jr. is, Tom Sr. is undiplomatic.
Right.
So there's an ego thing going on. You know, Tom Jr. has to be a public, public figure. And what's interesting is he doesn't shut his dad down. Like, he could say,
that's
Dad, can you just
that's
not?
That's what makes me think he's might be kind of a little interesting.
So I do think that there's like a, hey, it's just my dad.
Right.
But who doesn't understand? Lovely guy.
This leads to the logical question that I think everybody kind of has when you talk about Tom Brady and his dad. Kissing your son on the lips. Weird, not weird.
I mean... Not weird.
Yeah, I've thought about it. I don't do it with my dad. I don't do it with my son.
You know, it was weird.
But,
every family has basic,
you
know, sort of like norms, right? And what the abnorm there, is that a word? The abnorm
the
was
abnorm,
that there
the
happened.
The anti-norm.
Yeah, there were cameras around. And like, you know, that's not a natural situation. Yeah. Certainly wouldn't be for me. But I'm not going to judge.
Yeah,
I mean, look. I mean, there are far worse lines that people can cross that are far more problematic.
Yeah, so I probably should have said this before. We actually kissed on the lips. clips of every yes at the end of the show. So be ready, be
prepared.
Fabulous,
I'm ready.
Listen, we have our own norms on this show. And who are you?
This is or a anyone else space. This is a norm, our space of its own norm.
Okay, the cameras aren't even on. This is just something something I've been trying to make happen for so long. Okay, I met Donald Trump once. Mm-hmm. I met Donald Trump once. My son was a month and a half old, and my wife and I were still in that insanity of that. Right. And so we actually like, you know what, we're gonna go to a fancy restaurant just to get out of the house. And there he was, this was in 2011. Mm-hmm. He was in 2011, he was there with Melania. Mm-hmm. And I remember seeing him and thinking, oh, I felt like I was seeing like Rip Taylor.
Yes.
Or like just like this old character that like, oh, that's funny. It's a funny New York story. You know, like on Lanes, I ran into, you know, I ran into an old gossip columnist from Liz Smith was running around in there.
Yeah.
You've spent a lot more time. It didn't turn out. It turned out to there be more fortitude, maybe not fortitude, but he had more lasting power than perhaps I thought.
Yeah.
But you spent a lot of time. You've interviewed him. Sure. What is it like to physically be in the room with him for an extended period of time?
What is interesting about that, and it goes very much to what you're saying, the Rip Taylor character.
Yeah.
Good, excellent reference to Rip Taylor.
Confetti is like a fly out of this desk.
There are certain figures in the world that exist so fully on the screen, like they exist on the screen. It's just bizarre to be in their presence, no matter how long you're in their presence for. Like, so I profiled him in late 2015. Like, I spent a lot of time with him. And even, like, after, like, the fourth hour of the flight from, like, Dallas to L.A., wherever we were going, it was like, this guy is, like, actual him. It's not like a guy. And like, I had a friend in D.C. who, whenever you'd see, like, Ted Kennedy around, or Tim Russert was like this, too. I mean, there was, like, they're wearing masks.
Yeah.
It's like, that's someone that they're just, you know, there could be a Halloween mask, and yet it's actually him. So that always gave me a double take.
Yeah, I always felt like in baseball, I met Yogi Berra. I was in the Yankees spring training. Yogi Berra came in.
Yogi Berra.
It was just weird that, like, well, you're, like, not a fictional character. You're, like, an actual human being who, like, eats food and sleeps and walks around.
Yeah, I remember the first time this is actually somewhat random, but I'm going to tell the goofy little story.
Please
anyway.
Do. We love goofy
A friend of mine worked in the Clinton White House. First time I'd ever been in the White House, I was visiting him. He took me to the White House mess, which is like the where they all eat.
Right.
We're sitting there, and I'm thinking, all right, who's going to be the first like famous Clinton person I see? You know, George Stephanopoulos, you know, Mike McCurry, whoever. The first famous person I saw in the White House mess, Sherman Helmsley, who played George Jefferson.
Yeah.
Because, of course. Why wouldn't he be there? He was making some made-for-TV movie he was doing research, so he had to be at the White House. But, I mean, that would have been probably my second or third guess.
Yeah, that, of course. Helmsley, I always assumed.
Yeah.
I try not to say the nickname of the Washington football team aloud.
You're one of those people.
Does this make me smug?
No, but it's an affect.
Yeah.
An affect that has reason to exist. I mean, it's
like a thing.
The principle behind it.
It's like, well, I read the news, if that's what you mean.
Put it this way. You know, it's like, so whoever gave me this Diet Coke out there, we don't have straws in this place.
Yes.
So in a weird way, it's like a kind of like woke football fan equivalent of not having a straw. And by the way, I like straws. And I like saying
I don't even know how you're finishing this thing.
I like saying Redskins not because I think the name shouldn't be changed, and I certainly don't want to offend anyone, but it is a shorthand conversational thing instead of the Washington football team that we have to go off
then I have to be like, well,
which we just did for the last.
I understand. Well, listen, I'm just saying this show is anti-strangling of dolphin, and apparently you are pro.
I'm totally strangling
dolphins. Actually, I kind of hate dolphins, all told.
Really?
I don't really just.
They're a little overrated. You know what?
They're not smart. Like, they are the second smartest mammal, but they are not, in fact, intelligent.
Wait, who's the first? Are we the first?
Yeah, I guess we're sure.
So dolphins,
I guess they're gaining.
Dolphins are smarter than every other mammal except for us.
Yeah, but I think, I mean, that's debatable.
And look at some of the people we elect.
Yeah, I was going to say,
I mean, have dolphins ever elected, fill in the blank here, because we're nonpartisan here?
Dolphins
get a lot of credit because just the little curving of their mouth makes it look like they're smiling, so they're happy, so they project.
We think them like, like the Joker.
true, actually.
Okay, do you think that you could take John Heilman in a fight? John Heilman has been on the show. John and I have been friends for a long time, and I would like to see you two fight. Who do you think would win?
John is much bigger than me.
He's tall.
He's about 6'4", 6'5", or something like that. He dresses better. Yeah. I would say this. I would have my cunning and my savvy and my quickness and explosiveness to stun him.
Yeah. Kind of a juggernaut sort of thing.
Yeah, it would have to be a quick one. It would have to be, I think ultimately what
I mean, he's a California guy, so like I assume he's a little
California guy, but you know, he's a California guy, yes. And you know, he's always dropping Harvard. You ever hear that?
Also, did you know that he likes the Wu-Tang Clan? He's a big fan.
Yeah, I get that whole thing. But you know, he's got the whole brand. Yeah, he's so you can always like sort of take a brand. Right. So, yeah, sorry, John.
You can take him. Okay, two more. Yep. I remember reading a story about in the first few weeks after the inauguration about how all of these Trump staffers, these young Trump staffers, would try to date in Washington. They would try to date, and they would go on dates, and their dates kept getting ruined
because
someone would say, you're a member of Stormfront.
Absolutely.
Like, get out of here.
Yeah, no.
And I'm curious, knowing Washington the way you do, and it's been a couple of years now, do you think that's still happening, or do you people are just like, come on, there's not that many single people here.
No, I mean,
is this different in that regard? Like,
it is different. Yeah. I mean, I would say, look, I'm out of the dating market, and I, you know, it's so I can't speak from experience here.
But no kiss. I will say this. What we're saying.
My wife, you know, is like, she wants me to sell books.
Okay,
I would say that this is different from, I'm a Democrat and I will never date a Republican, or I'm a Democrat, or I'm a Republican if I would never bring home, you know, a Democrat. There's like a wall around Republicans who are actively Trump Republicans, because a lot of the Republicans you meet around Washington that I've known for years are pretty never Trumpy.
Yeah. I mean, it's like you can date a Kasich staffer.
Me personally.
No, not you personally, but like
it would depend.
They would be available
what
on Tinder.
She looks like.
Right.
I mean,
saying you, but available on Tinder. Right.
No, but available exactly. But having said that, I did. Well, first of all, we could as quasi media. Well, I'm quasi. You're actually a media writer.
I am.
We could talk about the sort of efficacy of the bogus trend story and whether this, in fact, was one and maybe a good bogus trend story. Maybe this really was a thing, but. Yeah, I think there's you make value judgments or people, you see people making value judgments around Trump people that you don't before.
Okay, I asked, this is the last question we do in every dubious, whatever the hell they call this thing.
Okay.
Are we going to be okay? This feels like an important question to ask every guest. You see what's going on.
I like that.
Yeah.
Have we used that before?
No, we use a different one for everyone.
That's a really good
one. It's both the nicest and the scariest of all the photos we've actually used on this.
Yeah, it's like a gift that doesn't move.
Yeah.
Are we going to be okay?
She's still behind me, isn't she? Are we going to be all right? Are we going to be okay?
Maybe not.
Maybe not, kind of...
I mean, I guess the glib, pat answer is yes, so I just decided to say maybe not.
Yeah.
Which is basically as much, you know...
that's literally the most optimistic answer we've gotten on the show
maybe
ever.
Maybe not.
So, okay, now we're going to play a game before we let you go. It's called Describe This Dope.
Okay.
Because one of my favorite things about your writing is you are terrific at, like,
painting
a scene,
dope.
Describing people. Yeah. I think you called Mark Davis a guy who might frequent Hooters for its all-you-can-eat wing...
Oh, that actually
that's
is
a thing.
True. That is a thing.
Okay.
That's not... That's
the all-you-can-eat specials and wears a fanny pack.
He does wear it. Both true.
Both
but
true.
Yes,
okay.
But
and Bill Belichick, of course, a talking hellish hostess that exuding a kind of personality antimatter with its own gravitational pull, which is... Correct.
Totally true.
So we're going to give you some pictures of people, and we'll work together on this.
We'll work together.
We are both elitist jerk media people who like to judge people.
Right?
That we, of course.
Also, we're older than everyone else in this whole.
Oh my gosh! They're all. They don't even.
Anyway.
I actually had one of the staffers here ask me. So what was it like when Bill Clinton was president? And
the attic dwelling millennials.
Yeah.
Man, they're everywhere.
Wow.
All right. So what camera do we look to?
I think we're going
to
look. We're going to put the picture here.
All right.
Okay, so the first photo is of Skip Bayless. Skip Bayless.
Oh, my God.
Okay, so Skip Bayless. Yeah,
how does that photo exist?
He actually put it on Instagram like 3 or 4 days ago.
Oh
he did. He's one of those, like, I'm swole bros
like
on
Alex
Instagram
Jones
guys.
Has one of those.
Yeah, yeah. This is
this
is kind of Alex Jones. I've noticed Alex Jones looks disturbingly like Garth Brooks now, by the way, if you ever get a chance to look into them.
Yeah.
But this feels like, to describe this dope, it kind of feels like...
I would just describe him as, first of all, you know he's had a lot of conversations and thought about whether to do something with the hair, which is very evident, because it looks like part of his sculpt, his physique, has been waxed, or it just, there's a hairlessness.
It's not entirely.
Except when there's not.
Spot,
I mean, I would describe it. It also, it's got like that odd kind of doorknob in the middle of
yeah.
there.
yeah. Oh, yes, that's a, that's I mean, a, he I looks, think that might be his heart.
It might be his heart, yeah.
It's all that left, all wow. the who's in Whoville.
That's
all
amazing.
All the heart, shrink and shrink
yeah.
and shrink.
His name is LeBron.
Okay.
Let's see. Yeah, do yeah. we need more?
I think that's good. All okay, right, next good. Up we got Joe no. Buck.
Joe Buck.
We got Joe Buck. And I like, for the record,
how
I like
can
Joe Buck.
St. Louis. How
I like Joe, like Joe Buck. There's something particularly kind of dopey. This kind of looks like.
It is a little. The
like a monorail salesman was actually kind of the way I was.
A
I was,
monorail
yeah,
salesman.
Like a guy that like shows up in the town and, you know, like.
In a way. You know, here's the thing. He looks like he's probably coming from somewhere where he probably tried badly to wash off makeup. And he still has the chapstick on.
Yeah.
He also, those yeah. glasses look like they probably cost more than I've spent on clothes for the last yeah. 10 years.
Yeah. I like the button, too. There's something like a little brazen about the button. I'd like to see him call the game sans top button. I think that would be kind of
He could, yeah. I mean, that's sort of an NFL owner thing.
Yeah.
Wait a minute.
No, you're good. Okay. I checked.
Okay,
we would have canceled this whole segment.
Yeah. No. A lot of, like, Robert Kraft, who, like, right, has right. 77 years yeah. old, he always has one button to
I always feel like the proportion that you are to date someone that is 30 or 40 years younger than you is directly proportional.
To whether you own an NFL right. team or yes. not, or whether you're suing your
whether
kids.
You, yes, whether
or,
you have the button.
There's a yes. whole bunch of... No, I'm all for him.
Okay, so a couple more, because we're running short on time.
Sure.
Okay, we're going to go with Gabe Kapler. Gabe Kapler, chiseled...
Is chiseled.
This is not one of the oiled pictures.
Yeah,
the oiled pictures. Yeah,
I mean, it's interesting. Oh, God, I mean, you know, the eye goes to the bubble.
Yeah, it's hard not to.
I mean, in a weird way, really. the bubble is like sort of a perfect metaphor for the way he managed the Phillies this year, because
yeah.
there actually was a bubble when it looks like it might have been working, yeah. but then it deflated.
And it popped in.
And it also doesn't. It looks like, is he really thinking about this? And yeah. it feels very involuntary.
Okay, and final one. Adam Silver. Adam Silver, NBA commissioner. Because I like Adam Silver, another guy that I like.
Everyone loves Adam Silver.
Every other. I feel like I'm waiting for the turn to Silver, because
exactly.
everybody hates commissioner. Ultimately,
yeah,
so it'll turn at some point. And I like him a lot, but he has a distinct look.
Oh, very distinct yeah. look. Well, I think that helps him. First of all, I will say that Roger Goodell and many people at the league are obsessed with Adam Silver, and they're obsessed with the negative comparison they always
yeah,
get
right,
to
right.
them. You know, do you do the ears? Do you do the eyes? I mean, he kind of looks like he's been drawn. I mean, he yeah. looks like he's been drawn by a cartoonist from, like, you know the earlier Mickey Mouse ones,
like not before, oh yeah, like Mortimer
yeah,
Mortimer Mouse.
I mean there's like
yeah.
a, I mean
Steamboat Willie.
Yes, you yes. have like the exaggerated yeah. features, and yet there's something a little bit not solemn, but yeah. like almost, I mean certainly delicate, but also just.
It feels like maybe like he just gave blood.
Oh,
kind of got a little bit of a just gave blood.
He has a bit of a just gave blood thing.
Yeah.
Wow.
So the point is, here are a bunch of people that are not as awesome looking as you and I.
That's Mark for Leibovich. Sure. By the way, Adam Silver, look, if he was not the NBA commissioner, he'd have to be a substitute teacher.
Yeah, he has a substitute teacher vibe.
Or like us.
Yeah. yeah. Okay, the book is Big Game, the NFL in Dangerous Times. You have to watch the show to hear the awesome essay that I gave you at the beginning.
Really?
I totally kiss your ass. I'm not going to lie to you. This is one of my favorite sports books in a very long time.
Really?
I'm actually a big fan of Citizens of the Green Room as well, which is it's a collection of the stories, so I always kind
yeah.
of love that. So I'm going full fanboy honk here. So,
well, you're the best. Could I do the same? I mean, I love Will Leitch. Forget it. No, I'm not going to say that.
It's Leitch.
I said Leitch. I almost said Leitch because that's how it's spelled.
Yes.
No,
I'm now hugging
my pillow.
The Leitches are famous for the refutations of traditional I before E rules. So we don't.
So, yes, me too.
Yeah, exactly.
I've been getting the German. Yeah. Yeah. Anyway.
Anyway, the book is Big
love
Game.
Love Will Leitch.
The book is Big Game. This is Mark Leibovich. So thanks for coming.
Find
the book. It is awesome. That is our show. Please come back to SI.TV for this show or wherever your Will Leitches are sold. Oh.